My name is Jim Caseman. Welcome back. And we're talking about how to get to know God intimately. Now, in order to get to God, know God intimately, we have to understand relationships. And we're starting off by talking about our relationship with God. It's a personal, intimate relationship. And we've come a long way. We started talking about this in session number 241, for those of you that are keeping track of the numbers of sessions. That's where we started talking about relationships. Now, we covered quite a bit of ground, but here's something that I want you to understand. In order, now, for God to redeem mankind, he has to do it legally. All right? Now, what happened in the Garden of Eden? Satan then used Adam and Eve's flesh, their physical body. He deceived them through the flesh. Looked good, tasted good, must be good. So it was through the flesh that the devil deceived the human, Adam and Eve, and ultimately through the flesh, then he ended up taking the entire human race into captivity through the flesh of Adam and Eve. Because from that point on, everybody that, all the children that Adam and Eve had the nature of sin, the tendency to sin, and all that sort of thing. And from that point on, man was born with the nature of sin. And of course, and what is sin? Sin is spelled S-I-N, the big I. I want. I don't care if you get hurt in the process. I want it. Selfishness. That's sin. It's death. Sin is another word for spiritual death. All right. So he took the human race captive through the flesh. Now, in order to redeem mankind, God's got to do everything legally and just right. Now, God had this, we don't know how far back it was when Lucifer sinned and rebelled against God and took one third of the angels with him. But God had a plan in his heart to redeem mankind before the beginning of time, and a plan in his heart to destroy the devil and strip him of all power and authority. He had that in his heart before the beginning. It says in the Amplified Bible, Titus 1 and 2, before the beginning of the world and the ages of time began. God only knows how far back that is. But there came a day when actually God so loved the world, he sent his only begotten son into the world to redeem the world. And whoever believed in them shall not, you know, perish, but have eternal life. Man, you know, that's a verse that how many years have we confessed that verse? But anyway, now I got to go back to John chapter 3. I'm a little embarrassed right now. I should have known that better, but I really messed up that verse. All right. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And then remember, we're over here in Romans 10 and 9, that if you confess, you got to receive this gift. But if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Now, why is it so important to believe that he's raised from the dead? Well, if he hasn't been raised from the dead, then we haven't been redeemed. He had to pay the death penalty in full. And then when he was raised from the dead, then, of course, he was resurrected as the Son of God, our eternal high priest. And, of course, he stripped Satan of all power and authority. But also upon his resurrection, remember, there was a foreshadowing of him in Genesis 14:18 with Melchizedek, one with an endless genealogy that Abraham paid tithes to. We see that again in Psalms 110, verse 4, and then Hebrews chapter 7, beginning of the verse 1. Jesus was resurrected as Melchizedek, fulfilled as our eternal high priest. He is our high priest now in heaven, and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Then he sees to it that everything he made provision for in the physical dimension through the blood covenant and his death, burial, and resurrection is made manifest in our lives. All right. Now, he's our high priest. But now, let's go back to what I originally wanted to do. Satan conquered the human race through the flesh. So God is going to have to redeem mankind through the flesh. Now, from the time that Lucifer tempted Adam and Eve, and even before, I mean, God, even before Lucifer did that, he already had this plan in his heart. And so this man, this plan now is fulfilled through Jesus Christ. He paid the death penalty for us. Okay, so this is how it works. Adam, I mean, Satan took the human race captive through the flesh. And now Jesus has to, the only way that he can restore as the second Adam, the only way he can become the head of the human race and take it back from Satan, he's going to have to do it in the flesh. So that's why Jesus has to literally take on the form of a human being, literally in every respect, and be clothed with the same sinful flesh we have. That's the only way that mankind's redemption can be paid for. Now, as he comes into this world with the sinful flesh that we have, now this is how the plan works. Now, this sinless man, Jesus, clothed the same sinful flesh we have, has to be willing to be tempted in all points, even as we are, yet without sin. Matthew chapter 4, first 11 verses, Luke chapter 4, the first 13 verses. See, he then in the wilderness, he was tempted in all points, even as we are. There wasn't any temptation that we have experienced that Jesus hasn't experienced. But yet he experienced all these things without sin, okay? Now, that's the first thing. Now, the second thing, he's got to be willing to die. Now, he has to die as a human spirit. He can't, you know, go to paradise. No, he's going to have to be dead spiritually. And we found that out last session because he was made sin for us. Now, upon his death, then, he, Jesus, spirit, the spirit man, the real Jesus, the human spirit, when he was made sin, he met the demand of the law. What was the demand of the law? The law demanded when you sin, you die. Okay, so Jesus fulfilled the demand of the law. He died sinless. He didn't die because he sinned. He died sinless. He offered up his life willingly. Willingly he died so he could meet the demands of the law for you and I. And then upon his resurrection, he defeated sin, death, and Satan was defeated. He became our high priest, and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Now, that's how it works. That'd be something that you'll want to remember. Hallelujah. All right. Now, upon his death and resurrection, he opened up the most holy place for you and I. Now, in the most holy place is the presence of God. This is what Adam and Eve were walking in before they sinned. And now finally, we come to the place where once again, you and I as mankind, we can walk in the immediate presence of God, just like Adam and Eve did before they sinned. So all of this took place a few thousand years, right? from the time of Adam and Eve, of course, it took 4,000 years. Up to where Jesus then actually paid the penalty for our sins, suffered the wrath and judgment of God for us, upon his resurrection becomes our high priest. Now that whole thing took about 4,000 years from the time that Adam and Eve left the presence of God because of sin up to where now once again the penalty for sin is paid. And now once again we can what? Boldly enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus Christ. We can walk in the immediate presence of God with no sense of guilt, condemnation, inferiority, just like before Adam and Eve even sinned. And the blood of Jesus continually cleanses us from all unrighteousness, so we can walk in his presence with no condemnation, guilt, or sin, and walk in his presence, no sense of guilt, condemnation, inferiority, 24 hours a day. I mean, we're back again to where it was before Adam and Eve sinned. That's the new and living way now. It's just not only the high priest that can go to the holy place, but now we are priests and the veil's removed and all of us can enter the most holy place, the immediate presence of God, and dwell in his presence and have that intimacy just like Adam and Eve did before they sinned. I am getting excited. But our time is up, don't worry. Oh, man. Anyway, looking forward to seeing you in the next session. Bless the Lord.